We're going to take you on a journey past sight and sound.
So please cover your eyes and block your ears unless you wish to be mortally offended. Too late.
We're going to take you back to the 1990s.
When the Backstreet Boys were still popular and the New Kids on the Block were the New Kids on the Block.
We're going to take you to the old auditorium.
But it wasn't actually the old auditorium because there was no new auditorium to make it the old auditorium.
So, we're going to the auditorium.
Yes, the auditorium, which was in a far, far, far away place through those double doors at the back there.
We interrupt the scene. We interrupt the dance team.
They're all practicing.
Dance.
To dance.
Dance.
Yes.
The following takes place between 1 p.m. and 2 p.m.
Approximately, give or take a few hours.
Or days.
Or mostly years.
True?
Yes.
It's made up.
It's mostly made up.
Anyway, the dance team now. Strike a pose!
Just look at what we have to work with.
I mean, it's brown.
Yep. It's small and it's really weird looking.
Sticky.
And furry and peeling in places.
Old.
Yeah, and I mean, this bit of stage isn't very good either.
What are we going to do? I mean, we're a qualified dance team here.
Well, yeah, I mean, we're qualified at dancing. We're overqualified at prancing. And of course, I've got my degree in twirlography.
You can even leave that out.
Well, if you guys decided to go to Sunshine Kindergarten too, you might have got it as well.
I mean, but we've got all this awesome talent, and look at the stuff we have to work with. I mean, it's decrepit.
I know, it's pretty limiting.
I mean, the stage has got holes in it.
Yeah, what about if we extend it?
Well, if we extend it, then we take away the chairs, so there'll be nobody there to perform to.
Yeah, good point. And I mean, we're pretty limited with that anyway. I mean, okay, what have we got to work with? Small stage.
Yep.
Limited seating area for the audience anyway.
Yep. Bad sound and lighting.
Hole in the stage.
Yes.
See what I mean about the bad sound and lighting? Yeah. Sorry, guys.
We're sorry. Yeah. We're just getting a bit off. Thank you. Otherwise, you're awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, so.
I think that did it.
Wouldn't it be good to, you know, to be able to just perform and have all the room that you need and all the equipment that you need?
Yeah, doing pirouettes without hitting anyone.
Yeah.
I know, and dancing and prancing.
It'd be cool to build this thing. You know, this amazing sort of venue. But would people come?
I don't know.
If you build it, they will come.
What?
If you build it, they will come.
Is that you, God?
Yes.
Why do you sound like Arnold Schwarzenegger?
I chose a persona you would respect.
I respect Arnold.
Yeah, certainly.
I know, he's pretty leafy.
He's pretty buff, yeah.
That's some guns.
Sorry.
If you build it, they will come.
What?
A big old auditorium.
Well, what would we build that for?
So you could have a bigger stage?
Why do we want a bigger stage for?
Okay, work with me, guys. What were you talking about 5 minutes ago?
I've got it. It was sandwiches, eh?
No.
Okay, I'll spell it out. Build a bigger auditorium, the bigger stage, more people.
Gotcha.
So, you know, does Jesus have anything to say about this?
I'll be back.
So, what do you guys think about this?
Bible talks about Jesus, and he always said he was going to come back.
Yeah, I believe he's going to come back.
I reckon he must be coming back.
No, I mean about building the building.
Oh, yeah, that sounds good too.
Well, yeah, I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
I mean, imagine it. We could build it right next to the oratorium.
Well, isn't that where the pastor's house is?
Oh, what are we going to do there?
We'll just knock it down.
Yeah.
Okay, so we knock that down and let's make it green.
Green. All right. With polystyrene in the walls.
Polystyrene in the walls.
Hey.
Like a fridge.
Yeah, so we can keep the heat out and the cold in.
Yeah. The stage would be massive.
Oh, yeah, man. We'd have tons of room. Like, that'd be real deep and real wide.
Yeah. And there'd be lights galore and
sound. And the lights would work.
Yeah. And we could do dances and dramas. And
we could do music and we could do songs and we could do...
And videos.
Yeah.
And cassette tapes.
Yeah. Awesome.
Maybe one day we could call it multimedia or something.
Well, we'd have to have more than one media, but yeah. Sure. Yeah. That'd be great.
And we could invite people and they would turn up and it'd be awesome.
Exactly.
And what could we call these things? What could we call these things that we could... something about...
super...
Califragilistic.
No.
Hyper...
Something about winning.
Mini Mark.
Winning,
not mini.
And a number two in it. what is that?
I just say a number two in
it. Yeah.
Win to seek.
Win to seek.
Win to seek.
Seek to win.
Oh, that's
hey,
good.
That's
yeah.
Catchy.
That's good, eh?
Like would you like to come to seek to win? I like it. Yeah.
I was doing it in the Indian accent, but you know.
Yeah.
Should we get started, eh?
Yeah.
All right, let's do it.
Okay,
let's
build. Does anybody know how to build around
no.
Here?
No.
Well, no. What do you mean by build?
I'm using a
hammer. What's a hammer?
Oh, let's build it anyway.
All right, let's start now.
Woo!
Thank you.
It's horrible.
Pretty rubbish, eh?
You know, sometimes feels like, you know, we're going backwards.
Yeah, or just not moving at all.
Yeah. You sort of think maybe, you know, 10 years on, after hearing God,
build it, there we go.
Well, we did the build it part. What about the build come part?
Build come part.
Yeah. Still waiting, really.
I don't know. I mean, okay, well, we did a good service today. I mean,
yeah.
You know, everybody worked hard. The items were good.
Drama's
great. But I mean, in general, it was a good service, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But, I mean, don't you just feel like it's, almost like it's a, I don't know, this?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, why do we do it? I mean,
got the stage, got the auditorium, got everything quality, and they're not here, you know?
Hey guys, what's happening?
Hey, bro.
Well, you guys are looking less than enthusiastic. What's up?
Well, we were just saying, like, it was a good service, right?
Oh, it was great, man. I mean, the dance, the dramas, the technical stuff was brilliant. And everything else, man, but yeah, wasn't it exciting? I mean, the message came across and everything seemed to flow. There was no holes. Wasn't it fantastic?
Lacking of people.
Yeah. But we had everyone on stage, you know, all the right amount of dancers and dramatists.
Audience people, visitors.
Yeah, I'll give you that. We were a little low, but let's face it, over the last 10 years or so, you know, quite a few people come through. It's really good and, you know, it works. I mean, look at the people, look at the lives we've touched. You know, the people's lives that we've affected.
Yeah, but what about recently? I mean, we haven't had very many people through it. You know, don't you feel like, you know, you get up early sometimes, you know, and you work hard and then you see, okay, well, nobody's invited anybody. So what's the point?
Well, okay, I'm just going to...
It's pretty demotivating.
Yeah, okay, well, I'll give you that. But look, here, just on the top of the head here, a weak question for you. I'm not going to make it too big because I don't want you to strain too much. But how many people have you actually invited?
Well, over 10 years.
Yeah. Well, look, I'll make it even easier for you. Over the last 3 weeks, how many people have you invited? Just a ballpark, you know. 10 to 20. All of you together, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to...
Yeah.
20 to 30?
No, lower.
Keep going.
10 to 20?
Keep going.
5 to 10?
What? How many have
I think I got one.
You think you got one?
I sort of threw it.
Threw what?
You threw the fly at the person.
Or was it a bug?
What did you actually say? Or did you run away screaming like a girl? Okay. What about you guys? Okay, so one sort of...
I was with them at the time, so it's mine as well, you know.
And I saw it happen.
So that's three.
Yeah, three.
Okay, good math skills. But, okay, no, it's only one, and I mean, sorry, guys, I'm not even going to give you that. Look, if we want people to come here, we've got to invite them. I mean, like you say, what's the point of us putting together these great dramas, dances, songs, really putting the effort in, coming down early, getting everything set up, if we're not going to invite people? The whole purpose of us doing this was so that we would get people into this church. And if we don't invite them, they're not going to come. Look, it's simple, man. Invite them and they will come.
That sounds kind of familiar, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. Build it that they will come.
No, but he said invite them.
Invite them and we will come.
Yeah, okay.
And then you guy told you that, did he?
Yeah.
No, but that's it, guys. Look, out there now, there's some flyers. Why don't we go grab the flyers, head down to the creek now, and invite some people. Let's get them in for tonight's service.
Let's try it.
Whoa! Here we go! Here we go. something about to break now. You know I feel there's a city here to take now. And it's not so tough for these ordinary hands. When we trust someone with extraordinary plans. You know I feel heart's about to break now. Cause I can see what the devil's trying to take now. We got a leather back book and a freedom cry. Where the army of God who are ready to die. You give us hope when the hope is gone. You fill the streets with a holy song. We're gonna paint this big old town red. Whoa! Here we go! Yeah! Here we go! Here we go! You know I feel this sky's about to break.
Thank you. Awesome, awesome, awesome stuff. Hey, give the team another hand. I want to thank you first, the worship celebration coordinators, allowing us to have a presence at the service this morning. We really wanted to encourage the church and thank the church for supporting a very vital part of the church, and that's the outreach services that we have every single week. And just to remind people about our mission, and our mission is really to, those services are specifically designed for your unchurched friends and families to come to a service that's non-threatening, that is able to draw them closer to God. And I have a little story about that. My cousin Nora, who recently moved to Brisbane, and she doesn't mind me saying this, she started coming to our seeker services last year. Actually, I think she came for about 2 years, and she refused to come to a worship service. Worship services were too threatening for her. She couldn't understand why she would want to be in a place of worship to God when she wasn't even in that place. And just recently, she moved to Brisbane, and she talks about how she came to Christ. She came through our seeker services. They are now stable in a church in Brisbane, worshipping God. She's attending worship services now. But it was a journey. And that journey, this is why I do what I do. This is why the mission is so important, such a vital part of this church. The reason why we built this stage, the reason why we built this auditorium, was so that your unchurched friends could come to an unthreatened service and we can get them drawn closer to God. Amen?
Amen.
So I encourage you, tonight as a creative arts service, please come, invite your friends. If your friends don't come, that's okay, come anyway. I invite my colleagues every single week on a weekly basis. They have not turned up once. And I know the reason why is because they have a perception about church that excludes them. And I know that one day when they do arrive, they're going to be like my cousin Nora. They're going to be worshipping God. But that first step into our seeker service, into our creative art service, is designed to bring them through safely. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So come tonight. Be blessed. Thank you for your time.
Right now, that Polly and I are glad to be back. Yeah, thank you very much. When you go to a church in a small community like Reeston, and there's all of six or seven of us there, and the whole church, and the church sits there, and we ended up having lunch with them afterwards, and we were talking, and one of the questions that God asked of me was, you know, why do people come to church today? What do you think it is? And they didn't quite use those words, but that was what they were asking me. I can't remember the exact wording of their sentence. And I started talking about the fact that the Lord has a passion for people outside the church, and people just won't turn up at church. Nora wouldn't turn up at church. In fact, it was because of Florence that Nora came. And Nora and Ray came to talk with us as a consequence. And God started to work. And God came here. But I can name numerous people who are here today who would probably never have come to church if church hadn't have come to them. That's the truth of it. In all sorts of different shapes and forms. Not just our seeker service, it happens through relationships primarily. Our seeker service is the best tool. And I want to talk about this morning. I really want to talk about this whole business of what it means. I've left something behind here. Thank you, Ben. I want to talk about what it actually means. And I want to come from an angle that might surprise you. Mind you, it might not surprise some of you at all. Because we've been talking about kingdom building, sons and daughters, that God's called every one of us in this room, whether we know him now or not yet. He has invited us to be part of his kingdom. We saw it so powerfully in that dance. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but should have everlasting life. That verse is so often quoted by scriptures but so little practiced. By people. Christians preach that passage ad infinitum, but don't practice what it means. And I want to show you what it's like. Some of you are going to have a little bit of humour. This is my humour, at your humour at my expense. Because I'm going to be talking about lessons from a gold pan. You see, the first thing that happened, I went away with Pauline and I, and after having children for 27 years in our home, we decided that we could now go gold panning again, which I did a little bit of before before we had children and before I even met Pauline, to a degree where I panned quite a bit of gold, really. And so I had these dreams of panning even better. So I got on the internet, and I discovered that you don't actually need to use a gold pan anymore to get gold. Did you know that? Don't need to use a gold pan. Well, not the gold pan that we know. Instead, you can actually do it quite differently, because the gold pan we know is a round thing that we do this with, and it gets very sore in the shoulders and the body and the back, and you name it, it gets sore. And especially if you're 55, it gets sore, right? So I found on the internet this design of a new type of gold pan, and here it is. I went away and I made one. There it is, with steps inside it. And instead of doing this like a normal gold pan, the promise is you'll get 5 times as much gold, and all it takes, and there's little videos on the internet and everything to show you how, and all you have to do is go like this. Put it in the water, you don't have to carry the weight of the shingle that you're panning in, and just put it in the water, it floats in the water, and it's really easy, because you can sit on a rock with this one and put it in the water and it floats away, because it's made of plastic, you see? And it floats away and you go real fast, and the guarantee is that gold is going to go to the bottom and you'll get 5 times more than you will in an ordinary gold pan. So off we go. And on top of it, I made this great big sucker that you can see in my hand. It used to be an air pump or an air bed, but I converted it into a sucker and put some attachments and did a few things. This is while I'm on holiday, see, we're having holiday. I have to do something because otherwise I drive Pauline insane and myself insane. And so I made this sucker. What the idea was, I'd only suck up all the fines, it's a little wee stones, and I'd blow them into this little gold pan. I'd pan away, and then when I got to the bottom and there's very little left in it, I'd get over an ordinary pan, this little one, and I'd pull the rubber bung out, and out would drop the gold, a little bit of swishing, and then I'd put the rubber bung back in, and I would continue to get more and more gold. Well, if you look at the journey, you'll see that I was there filling the gold pan, and then here I was panning in a little stream. There's one problem. I handmade this, and I couldn't get any rubber to go with it. I took the plastic with me and I forgot about the rubber. So I found a piece of tubing, and I made it fit, and you've got to say, it looks pretty good, doesn't it? Fits pretty well. But if you get to the light and you look through it, unfortunately, there were little holes. So I would squeeze it like this, you see? And I'd get the thing and I'd squeeze to make the round rubber a little bit flatter so it'd fill the hole. And I looked in, I've stopped it. Filled it up with shingle and I panned away. And very expectantly, I pulled out the bung over the gold pan and panned out the last little wee slivers. There was no gold there. And we were panning in rivers that do have gold in. We didn't go panning in the wrong kind of rivers. We knew we were going. There are approved sites you're allowed to go to nowadays. So I got my ordinary pan out. And I panned with my ordinary pan. And I struck gold with my ordinary pan. I've got multiplicities of gold. Altogether, I couldn't weigh it because I didn't have any scales. But even if I did have scales, I probably would have needed pretty clever scales because I got three flakes, one of which I dropped back in the river. If you have a magnifying glass, you might see them. Three flakes. And Pauline will tell you, I filled the pan, and I panned the pan. This is the ordinary pan. Somebody dropped the lights a little bit. Sorry, it's a bit darker than I thought it was going to show. This is me panning. And you can see what's happening if you look. I'm enthusiastically putting single in the pan there, and then this is me trying to pan. Because there was no results happening. Not the results I wanted. And I think sometimes we can feel a little like that as the people of God. And I sat with the people in Reefton, and we talked and shared, and I had this picture. There's a whole bunch of young people in the community. There was no young people in the church, by the way, apart from two young girls, and one was brought along by a friend from the Catholic Church. And the other young girl would come with the mother, but, you know, that's it. That's the church. And I bled for them. Because they thought that people should just turn up at church. And I've got to tell you, it might have been a small church, but they had a wonderful little service. No musicians, so they had background recorded music, and they did it very well. Best I've ever seen any church do that. Message was great, in fact, very good. Content and all the rest of it. And they wanted to know, why don't people come? Why don't people come? Because they really felt they had gotten the anointing from God. And I believe they have. They have got God's hand on their lives. He loves them. He moves in their lives. He works wonderfully. But the question that arises for me, and we had the experience of working with a new church that's forming in Christchurch. We had a Hosanna Network Churches Conference, and then we worked with Parklands Baptist on Sunday afternoon with some of the leadership there. And then, and I know it doesn't sound much like a holiday, but we kind of arranged our holiday around this weekend, you know. And then Sunday night, not by plan, but because as I was walking into the meeting, I was asked by the leader who had flown up from Christchurch to Wellington here when around the time Pauline's mum died. In fact, the week that Pauline's mum died. And he'd flown up here to talk with me because he knew us. He's known us for over 20 years. And he wanted to work through some issues. And they asked us some questions. Now, what is church? Because I'm trying to figure this out because I really want to do it right. This is new church. What is church? It's not part of the Hosanna Network, by the way. It's a group that's is affiliated elsewhere. And they want to ask, you know, what is church? If we get anointed, what is it for? And I want to say, I was a little bit disappointed this morning because I had inserted a video into my program only to discover that Derek had already nicked it a couple of weeks ago. The same video. How did he do that? I just snuck onto my computer and got it, you know? No? But you see, one of the things that really, really disturbs me is the amount of selfishness in Christian faith for many people. And it's not meant to be that way. It's not about me. We sing that song, don't we? It's what about? What's it about? Hello? What does the song say? It's all about you. Actually, it's all about God. It's all about His purpose. But it's all about the message that He gave. It really is all about that message. For what? Well, I want to suggest it's anointing not for our own selfish needs or wants. Actually, not what needs, wants. Because God will fulfill all the needs we have. He's promised to do that. We don't have to try and get it. He's promised to do it. Amen? For what? Well, I want to suggest to the whole bunch of people out there, like the guys portrayed so brilliantly this morning, who are lost. And I want to talk about this because I went through the scriptures very thoroughly in my research for this message. And one of the things I discovered, I'd known a little bit sort of in my heart about this, but I hadn't looked at the specific detail of it, but I did some really hard searching through scriptures. I want to tell you something. You know how, can anybody guess how often in the New Testament, not the Old Testament, because New Testament's the only thing that applies to the Christian church in terms of what actually happened in the church or what should apply in the church. How many occasions do you think the New Testament talks about actually worshipping God and instructions on worship? How often would you think? Somebody like to take a wild guess.
Seven.
How many times?
Five.
200. 204. 50. 100. 500. Somebody was very shrewd and knows me well enough to know that it's probably not going to be what you would optimistically perhaps think as Christians. In total, in the whole of the New Testament, there are 10 occasions when it talks about worship, and most of them don't give any instruction. Some of them are only statements like Jesus, when he was being tempted and the enemy had a go at him, he said, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Well, that doesn't really give us much instruction, just says to worship God, and that's good. There are passages yet that says, "Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in spirit and truth." And so that passage is pumped to the hilt by a whole lot of people who claim to be Christians, and people wanting to say, that's what we're here for. Because it's immediately translated into standing and singing to God. In fact, some churches have gotten to the point where if you get a 10-minute to quarter of an hour sermon and 45 minutes of worship, that's the balance they think should be in the church. I want to tell you something. That never, ever, ever happened in the New Testament. Ever. In fact, Paul, in one of the passages that does speak about worship in Corinthians, Paul actually really has a go at the church because they have become excessive in their worship and the things they were considering to be worship. You see, the scripture says something very different about it to what we might expect and what we've perhaps been taught. You see, generations of church talked about worship. One of the things they talked about is you sing these great hymns and you hear this message, and that is worshiping God. And it's not. It is a part of worshiping God, but it is not worshiping God. It's an incorrect concept. And you can see the consequences of that kind of thinking with the churches that have practiced it and continue to practice it without a balance. They are dying. Some of the horrific rates. One of the shocking things I discovered a few weeks ago, and I'm sad about this, I'm not glad about it at all. I think it's one of the saddest things. Presbyterian Church, which was a great church, and there are still a number of great Presbyterian churches around New Zealand. But they lost 91,000 people in the last 20 odd years. Why? Because when people get together for their own pleasure instead of for God's pleasure and doing God's purpose, that will happen because God will not shine on that kind of thinking. I want us to think this morning about what the scripture does say. In the scripture, if you're talking about the anointing, you talk about the context of what says. We read in 2 Corinthians 5:14 to 21. For Christ's love compels us because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died, and he died for all. That is, those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them. It's not talking about living on Sunday services. It's talking about living for Jesus Christ every day. That's what it's talking about. And was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Now I want you to do something with me. We don't very often do here in this congregation. I'd like you to read the next passage with me. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone. The new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sin against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. What has he committed to us? Reconciliation. Reconciling man to God. That is the intent and purpose of God. The last bit, let's read together. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. Now, Paulie and I had something very interesting happen. See, there's a little wee church in Reefton. In the middle of a prayer meeting on the Sunday night, where they got together with another little wee church, a woman had a word for us, and she would have had no idea about what we're about to do this weekend in the service. This was planned to happen this weekend, obviously before I went away, because I only turned up 2 nights ago, and these guys had put this all together. And she had this word that God was saying to us that we in particular have a very strong ministry as ambassadors, as ambassadors of Christ, Christ's ambassadors. And I believe that God is speaking to us as a church. I'm so glad that our team have revisited the whole Seek to Win service, because, you know, there are some philosophies around that say things like, you know, when there's true anointing of God on a service and people come to Christ, they might, if you could get them there. And even then, when I've seen them there, very few people over the years, in my experience of 29 years of pastoring, very few people have come to Christ through a worship service. If it were true what so many people say about worship and anointing of God being on the place and people get converted wholesale and in abundance, there's lots of churches that have those kind of worship services and they're great people and great churches, but I want to tell you now, they're not bursting at the seams. The only people they attract are people from other churches because they're doing something different. And I frankly am not, as a pastor, interested in doing that. If people come here, that's up to them. But if they've left their previous church out of conflict, I want to help them deal with that in their past experience. Because I believe the integrity of the gospel is such that we do not cheat steal, that we do not become wolves, that instead we become the people of God, doing the things of the people of God, and supporting other people who are running other churches and doing the things of people of God by not stealing from them. Because Jesus calls people who do that wolves. And I don't want to be a wolf. Some of you know I've been strong in that over the years. But one of the things that happens, and one of the things that's been understood, and there's been people in church who've done some significant research, the Barnard Group and another group called the Rainer Group. Both these groups say the only way that a church truly will grow and see God move in the way that he wants to move is if they are willing to suffer considerable pain. If The Rainier Group did a whole lot of research on all the churches they call breakout churches in the world that have seen significant growth. And every one of them went through a journey of pain to get there and to see the things that God's now doing. And some of you have been going through some pain. And some of us have been through pain over the years. But sometimes when we get pain, we lower the bar. We do, we lower the bar. In the old days, we're behind the eight ball. It's a term that's used in English. I am so pleased that I was a bit apprehensive when Ross allowed it to go beyond three or four people that were going to have sharing this morning, because he said three or four, and he got flooded, poor guy. And how do you cope with that when he said you say three or four and then ten turn up, you know? He let it run this morning, and I think he was right, because what actually happened is that both John and JD got up and shared something I think that God has been speaking to people about for a long time here. What is that commitment? Is it to God? Or is it to work? I think we need to go and work and earn an income, because the scripture says that. Did you know that? In fact, it says if you're not prepared to work, you shouldn't eat. That's what the scripture actually says. Now that doesn't mean, you know, for some of you unemployed here, there's no criticism of you because you're unemployed. That may not be your fault at all. But if you're unemployed, you still should work. Find somewhere to go and volunteer with, because that's a biblical principle. And in fact, if you go and do that, you're likely to end up getting a good job if you're facing unemployment. That's true. So that's a little aside, but let's come back. And by the way, we've got somebody who's doing that here. Michael's coming to the church every week, and he's been cleaning this place and looking after us and helping us. He's doing it. There's others who have been doing the same thing. Now, I want to say to you, we cannot afford to lower the bar. And when John and JD got up and shared today, they said something that was very important. God was being put first in their lives. That's what they were saying. No working Sunday. John has struggled with that for a long time. He's got this lovely, soft heart. And most of us know, you clapped him here earlier. He's got this lovely, lovely, soft heart, but it's so soft when somebody's put pressure on him. Even though he had, in his original agreement with his work, he wasn't going to work Sunday, they put pressure on him because employers will try to do that to you because they are interested in getting more of this. And we need more Christians who are going to stand up like these two brothers have and say, this is where I stand. And to trust God to guide us. If we stand with God, in the end, we will be an influence in the community that will be great. Because it's not about what we get, either in worship in the church or in employment outside there. It's about who we are and what we give. The ministry of reconciliation. We are ambassadors for Christ. Christ has called us to do that, and we cannot afford to lower the bar. Now and again, I've had pressure put on me in the church. Why do we do so many sequences? Why don't we just back off? Why don't we just spend more time worshipping? You know, if we worship more, then this will happen. And usually it comes from people who have been converted elsewhere. But the reality is, if you look at the training that Jesus gave his disciples, they did spend some time worshipping, but they spent heaps and heaps of time reaching out to lost people. That was the primary objective. You know, we're going to have eternity to stand in front of God and worship Him, and I think that's glorious. I think it's a wonderful thing. But although that might start in small measure here, I would want to be able to stand in heaven and not feel guilty about any of my neighbours. To know that every one of my neighbours had the same opportunity to spend eternity worshipping God, being with God. I would hate, and I mean this seriously, I would hate to turn up in heaven and for God to look at me and me to mate, because you see, the scripture says we'll have all knowledge at the moment we're in heaven. If you look at 1 Corinthians 30, knowledge and prophecy and tongues will pass away. Why? Because at the point we meet Him face to face, we will have all knowledge. And as I stand in front of God, everything that I have and have not done, I will be totally aware of without any spent hours thinking about it. Because time doesn't even exist in the way that we understand it. Everything I have and have not done, I will be looking in the face of God and I will probably immediately feel a bit sad about some of the things I didn't do and the things I did wrong. And the, you know, the lack of commitment or the lack of willingness to serve God in the ways that He wants. The lack of ability to stand up for Christ in the way that He would like sometimes in my life that I've had in the past. Oh yes, people emphasize the thing, you know, we're going to glory in the great things that happen with God. But I don't think we have anything in the scripture that says we're not going to be aware. In fact, there's some passages that says there is awareness. Now, some of the parables of Jesus, there's total awareness of what people have done. You see, it's not about what we can get. It's really about God's will. And here's three faces. Who in the last year, I'm aware of, who stepped up to the bar and somewhere or another and God speaking to them. I know there are many other faces, but they happen to be three that just popped into my head and I trust that God gave me the right three. If you know they've been naughty in the last period of time as well, you go and talk to them personally. That's not my issue. All I know is that they have been good in some things with God. Amen? You see? Because I've stepped up to the bar and I've wanted to serve Christ better than they have ever before. Wanting to follow Jesus. And it's all about God's will.